OBS Studio version 25 is officially out. It's been about 6 months since they released version 24, so that means 6 months of new features, new functionality, as well as some performance improvements as well. In this video, we'll be rattling through the 25 most important new features in OBS version 25. Some of these are big new changes and some of them are little improvements, but I wanted to get through absolutely everything so that you have the best chance of making the most of OBS version 25 for your live streams. Okay, so the first thing you need to be doing is making sure you're running on OBS version 25. So go up to the help menu, click check for updates and make sure you are fully updated. Sometimes there's a couple of hot fixes straight after the release, just fixing some bugs that came with version 25. So just make sure you're on the latest version. Okay, so the first thing that we're gonna be covering is the added support for Vulkan game capture. This means that you can now use OBS to capture games that use the Vulkan graphics rendering API. Things like Doom Eternal, Rainbow Six Siege, No Man's Sky, Dota 2, as well as so many upcoming titles. So what is Vulkan, you might be wondering? Effectively, it's just a graphics rendering API, exactly the same as DirectX, but DirectX has been built by Microsoft and only works on Windows machines. So games developers nowadays, because they want to be building for more than just the Windows platform, they're going to be using things like Vulkan, because that API is available across Windows, Mac OS X, Android, Linux, consoles as well, so it's much easier for them to port their games to different platforms. Effectively, what this means for you is it's just more support for games to be captured through the game capture method in OBS. Next, we have some improvements to the window capture options. They now allow capturing of browsers, browser-based windows, and Microsoft Store or UWP programs. Effectively, what this means is it now lets you capture things using window capture that you weren't able to do before. The downside of this new method is that it can cause a little bit of cursor lag and it will give you a highlighted border around the captured window, but the border itself won't actually be captured. That's just for you as the streamer to see. Next, we have a highly requested feature, which is to allow you to import scenes from different streaming programs. So if you've ever used OBS Classic, XSplit, Streamlabs OBS, or maybe OBS on a different platform like OS X, you can now import your scenes using the menu bar, scene collection, and then import. And then you can bring those scene collections that you've designed in other programs into OBS Studio. One thing that I did realize that you could do now is that you could technically use Streamlabs OBS and use their massive suite of free scene collections that they have available, install them in Streamlabs OBS, and then import them across to OBS Studio. So I guess that's a little tip for all of you that are starting out streaming and you want to make use of some of Streamlabs OBS themes and widgets. Next, we have the ability to drag and drop browser sources straight into OBS. What this effectively means is that you can drag and drop browser sources and they will retain certain parameters that you need for that browser source in your streaming software. Hopefully, we'll get alert services like Streamlabs and Stream Elements, as well as some of the stream design companies like Nerd or Die, VBI, or OwnTV, adding these buttons to their websites so that we can simply just drag and drop them into OBS and they'll already have all of the correct parameters. OBS has added some source icons just to make things much easier to see at a glance. These are just little icons next to each of your sources to help you differentiate which source is which. If you combine these icons with the grouping of sources and the coloring of sources, it's going to make the organization for you in your streaming software much easier. But if you would prefer to disable these, you just go up to the view menu and you can disable the icons there. From sources to scenes, OBS have added a scene grid mode. All you have to do is right click in the scenes box, choose grid mode, and you can see it goes from sort of a list to a more button style interface. For those of you that use studio mode in OBS, you can now have a T-bar or a transition bar, which allows you to control the transition between your two different scenes. But do note that this doesn't work with any stingers or basic cuts. It only works with things like fade or luma wipes. For those of you that have signed into your Twitch account through OBS, they have added an option to enable or disable some of the chat extensions that you can use in the Twitch chat panel. So those are the Better Twitch TV and the Frankerface chat extensions. So you can use all of those custom emotes and you can actually see them in the chat panel. You can now quickly rename your sources, your filters, and your effects just by highlighting it and pressing the F2 key. Talking of filters, they've also added the ability to add the cube LUT filter type in your webcam properties or any kind of video source. Previously, you had to use PNG files, but now they've added support for the more commonly used .cube LUT files as well. This should be particularly useful for those of you that do some kind of video editing, and maybe you have a LUT filter that you use in your video editing software, and you can now match it exactly in OBS as well. In the mixer, they have added the option to lock your volume so you don't accidentally change things on the fly. All you have to do is right click and choose to lock volume. They've also added an option to use percentages rather than decibel in the advanced audio properties just by right clicking the items in the window. So if you would prefer to use a percentage rather than a decibel value, you can customize that here. Whilst we're on audio, they've also added an option to show all the audio sources to advanced audio settings. For those of you that are using a replay buffer in OBS, they've added a button to save the current replay buffer. If you make use of having the OBS projection on a separate screen, you can now change the projection type by right-clicking on the context menu. For those of you that have got the Logitech StreamCam, Logitech's new webcam, I did do a video review of that, I'll link it up in the top card. They have added support for those kind of devices that automatically rotate the camera output when you rotate the camera. To save you a bit of time when you assemble a new scene, you can now copy and paste multiple selected sources into new scenes if you'd like to. A small quality of life improvement that they've done is that now in the system tray icon, it will show when you have a recording paused. If you are making use of scrolling text or the scroll filter in any of your sources, they've added an option to be able to toggle looping on that source as well. Another small quality of life improvement that they've made is the default source sizes now when you actually add a source to a scene. They've improved that. So usually when you added a text source, it was super tiny up in the top corner, and they've just improved the default sizes now. They've also added a new transition to the quick transitions in studio mode, which is fade to black. If like me, you use OBS Studio to do a lot of recording of gameplay or tutorials or things like that, they've added some string specifiers to the file name formatting option in the advanced settings. So you can now specify certain settings like resolution and FPS to your recording file names. Another improvement for people that use OBS for recording is that they have now added a hotkey to reset the stats window or the stats panel whilst you are recording. In the video settings tab, they have also added an aspect ratio to make sure that your canvas and output resolutions are at the right aspect ratio. This should hopefully solve a lot of people that have been streaming with black bars because they've entered the wrong resolution. Lastly, they have removed the older and now depreciated NVENC encoder from the advanced output mode to just prevent some confusion. So previously you had both NVENC new and NVENC, which was the old one. Now you'll only see NVENC new, which eventually they're apparently going to just rename back to NVENC, but you can still use the old NVENC if you want to do something like rescaling. It automatically falls back to the older implementation. But like I said in my NVENC video, I definitely recommend using the new implementation because it's a lot more efficient and should give you much better performance. A quick call to action. I actually did a full interview with the guy who started this whole OBS Studio thing, the main guy behind it, Jim. If you would like to check out that podcast episode, I have it linked down in the description below. Thanks as always to the Gaming Careers patrons who have supported the channel this month. And I wish all of you to stay safe, stay indoors, stay streaming, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace.